If you have a Bible, Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11. Read a couple verses, then we'll read some verses out of Genesis, and then we will jump into this lesson that I'm excited about. Hebrews chapter 11, verses 8 through 10. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to a place that he was to receive as an inheritance. He went out not knowing where he was going. By faith, he went to live in the land of promises in a foreign land, living in tents with Isaac and Jacob, heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to a city whose foundations, whose designer and builder is God. That's an awesome, awesome passage. And then Genesis chapter 12, verses 5 through 9. And Abram took Sarah, his wife, Lot, his brother's sons, and all their possessions that they had gathered, and the people that were they had acquired in Haran, and they set out to go to the land of Canaan. When they came to the land of Canaan, Abram passed through the land to the place at Shechem, to the oak of Moreh, at the time the Canaanites were in the land. Then the Lord appeared to Abram and said, to your offspring I will give you this land. So he built there an altar to the Lord who had appeared to him. From there he moved to the hill country, the east of Bethel, and pitched his tent with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. There he built an altar to the Lord and called upon the name of the Lord. And Abram journeyed on, still going towards the Negev, which means going towards the south. Let's pray. We will jump into this. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for the way you work, the way you move, the way you draw us together. Lord, I know that things are different. I know that times are different, but you're still in control. And Lord, we just thank you for the opportunity to gather together. Thank you for the opportunity to be able to be here. Yes, we have to make some changes and we make some adjustments, Lord, but the big thing is that we have you and we have each other. And that is what is important to us. So we are thankful for that. Lord, I just thank you for the message about traveling today that was able to just kind of speak to me as we were traveling, Lord. And I'm thankful for the way that you bring passages into our lives at times that fit us, Lord. And Lord, just speaking of traveling, Lord, as my family manages to stretch an 8-hour trip into 11, Lord, we thank you for coffee and how it helps on the drive. And then it helps the next morning when we wake up. And it is good. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I was mentioning this. I learned a lot of lessons this week. I learned a lot of things, really. I learned that it's possible to fish for 8 hours and never catch one fish. That was not a fun lesson for me to learn. I had my 8-year-old nephew with me, and I paddled him around in a canoe for 8 hours with no bites. The only thing that bit us was mosquitoes. It's this place we went to is called Big Island Lake. And I told my family, I said, we should come up with a slogan for Big Island Lake. And it's Big Island Lake, where the fish don't bite, but the bugs do. Because we got tore up. I remember now being up there this past week that mosquitoes up there are twice as big as mosquitoes here. They are massive. Another thing I learned was how to drive a tractor with a wagon full of hay down a hill into a barn without crashing it and not knowing how to actually drive the tractor. That was an adventure. My brother has more faith in me than I did in him, so he rode on the very top of the hay wagon down a hill into a barn. I had never driven this tractor in my life. And so that was quite something. That was special. I also learned that you can smell a picture. Now, I know you don't believe me that you can smell a picture, but you can. And here's proof. We went fishing for an entire day. There is where my family lived, where we went fishing, there's no showers, there's no outhouses, there's no toilets, there's nothing, right? And all of my little nephews swam in the lake before we left. And they swam in the lake when we got back. And then that night, when we finally arrived back at our house, they just all went to bed. No showers, not changing clothes, no nothing. And the next morning when we woke up, my mom took a picture of all the boys waking up on the floor. And I was like, Mom, I can smell how bad that picture smells just by looking at it. Like, it's true. You can actually smell. It was something. Another thing I learned, and this is what actually has to do with the sermon, is that the town that my parents grew up in is called McMillan, but it was supposed to be called Newberry. And the town 10 miles away is called Newberry, but it was supposed to be called McMillan. But they both got founded in the 1883, I think, is when they were founded. And they had to use a train to bring the signs to drop off the name of the town. And whoever was responsible for bringing the signs dropped the wrong signs at the wrong town. And so in the 1800s, they didn't know what to do. They just thought that was the name of the town. So they have been named the wrong names since they've been founded. So in 2020, my parents live in McMillan, which should have been Newberry, and they went to school in Newberry, which should have been McMillan. There's a lot to do with names of towns, right? There's a lot to do with names of places. We know right now there's a petition on 97.1 The Fan to rename Columbus Elbow Drop City, USA. I happen to think that's a great name. I think there's Flavor Town. There's all these interesting things about Columbus. Should we change the name? I'm not into any of that. But it's fascinating how much power names have of places. And that's what's so amazing to me about this story. God says to Abraham, hey, I want you and your family to just head out. Well, I'm not going to tell you where you're going. I just want you to do it. So he has to leave a place where he's from with no idea where he's going or what it's called. Now, if you think about it, like if God were to say to us, hey, I want you to leave Westerville, but you're going to go to a town that's called Healthville and Rich Person, USA, most of us would strongly then consider, oh God, maybe you want me to do this, right? Like if we went and moved to a town that was called this beautiful, amazing name, we would consider it. Abraham has no idea where he's going, how he's getting there, or what the name of the place is. So I was thinking about that as we began to get ready for this sermon, and I was thinking about the power of the fact that God didn't include the name of the place, but he included all these other names. So I started thinking about why God would put these other names in the story at all. Like, why bother? If you're not going to put the name of the place you want him to go, why bother putting all the rest of the names in? But God does, and there's a very specific reason. But I want to point out one thing before I jump into this. Everywhere that Abraham went, he brought his tent and family and an altar. Which shows us that the name of the place is not that important. It's not where I am going in life, it's who am I going with that matters. It is not where am I going in life, it is who am I going with that matters. We can become consumed with where am I going at this stage of my life? Where am I going in my relationship? Where am I going in my career? Where am I going in this? Where am I going in that? But the real important question is, are you going with God and those he's called you to live around? Now, our families all look different. There was 24 of us, I believe, 27 of us, all in one house, which we quickly moved to several houses once we figured that out. Our families all look different. But who do you have in your life with you that you would call your family? And are they going with you on your spiritual journey? But I want to look at the names of the places where Abraham and his family did go, and I think they'll show us some really important things. The first place that Abraham was at is the place he had to leave. It's called Haran. It means a road or a mountain place, but it also means parched. The idea of Haran was it was this very old city. It was a really hard natural road in the middle of a bunch of mountains where trade was done. So because it was naturally able to be used by people everywhere to travel, it was a very affluent, very wealthy, very prosperous town that he lived in. But it was also called a dry place or parched. They worshiped a god here called the sun god. And the sun god, they worshipped him because they thought that if they made him angry, it would get so hot that they would all die, because this happened quite regularly. It was a very wealthy, very affluent place, and yet it was very dry. Which I think shows us that finances don't always equal blessings from God. The world is full of rich people who are parched or dry morally and spiritually. And we cannot assume that just because someone has blessings or financial things in their life, that God is blessing them. Just because someone has a nicer car doesn't mean God loves them more than you. Just because someone has a bigger house doesn't mean that God is blessing them. We often hear, well, God's blessing them, but we can't always equate finances with blessing. Finances can be a blessing, but they're not always a blessing. Abraham had to leave this very financially affluent place, but it was dry. And the world seems to be full of people with what we in America consider to be blessings that are morally dry. They want to bend the rules and break the rules to get ahead, or spiritually dry, and there's no life in them. We also can't assume that just because things aren't going great that God isn't good. Abraham leaves a really good place, and he gets on this road, and as we'll see, things get pretty rough, but God is with him the whole time, and God is good. The next place he goes is a place called Shechem. It's pronounced in the old school Shechem, and it's pronounced nowadays Shechem. But it means a place of promise. It means a place of promise. God's first promise to Abraham was given here. God promised Abraham, your descendants will someday be here. So thousands of years later, hundreds of years later, Joshua brings Abraham's descendants to this very place. And he says, God delivered on his part of the promise, and now you need to promise to follow God. And the children of Israel make their promise to follow God right here. There's also Jeroboam and Rehoboam, who one of them was promised to be the king and rule here, and the other one actually lived in his place as they fought against each other. But what struck me was that there's another promise. This is the place where Jesus promises eternal life to the Samaritan woman. And this town is still around today. It is one of the oldest cities in the world. You can still go and excavate and look at Shechem, which shows us that God keeps his promises forever, and we can trust him. We can trust his promises to us. God promised something so long ago, and yet this town still remains as a living proof to you that when you begin to doubt, you can trust God to keep his promise. He promises things like this: I am with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. I am with you even until the end of the earth. And it's easy right now to begin to doubt that. It's easy to begin to question that. But look at what God brought Abram through. And look at that place still standing as a living testimony to the fact that when God promises something, he keeps his word. This is hard nowadays, because nowadays people don't keep their word. They just don't. There's people who, if they promise you they're coming, it means they're not. And if they say they're not coming, then you just get out of place because you know they're actually going to show up. Right? But this is why we have contract after contract after contract, and we have to go through all these legal issues, right? Because people don't keep their word anymore, but God does. God keeps his promises. And I found it fascinating that Abram leaves this wealthy but spiritually dry place, and God's first place he brings him to is a place where he keeps his word to him. Secondly, he goes to a place called Moreh. This place means teacher. It was a big open plain, or like huge open field, but it was extremely difficult to get through and across. And sometimes God has to bring us to a place, maybe it's July 2020, to teach us some things. Sometimes God has to walk us to a place that is difficult. Sometimes God has to go with us into a place that is tough and there's opposition. But sometimes the opposition is actually the opportunity that God's trying to give us. All opposition can be a lesson from God. We can take all opposition, all the struggles that we face, and we can ask God, what am I trying to learn? I wonder how many times, just think about this, when you get to heaven, I wonder how many times, looking back, you'll realize that you asked God to take something out of your life, that because it was hard, but God was actually using it to teach you a lesson. I remember we first started, man, there were struggles, and we would say, God, get rid of this. But it was actually a lesson that we needed to learn in 2020. And there's so many lessons through obstacles that we can learn. There's so many things through opposition that we can learn. Maybe we have opposition in our lives because God wants to teach us how to communicate better. And we're just not communicating well. Maybe it's to be positive in difficult times. You ever hang around someone who's like chronically negative? And after a while you're like, boy, can you say anything positive? Like, can we talk about anything besides politics right now? Can we just please discuss, hey, the Columbus Crew won 4-0 last night and soccer is back. That's positive, right? Can we talk about coffee? Coffee's always positive, right? You ever talk to someone who's just negative about everything? Maybe God's trying to teach us through some of these difficult times to learn how to be positive in a rough world. Maybe it's to be determined to get through, because he's about to go to a place that is incredible, but he has to get through this tough lesson in order to get to a good place. What's fascinating is the Bible mentions the Canaanites in there. The Canaanites, these people who forever are going to oppose the children of Israel, his descendants. They're going to forever be their enemies. And yet, there's things we can learn from our enemies. Anyone should be able to teach us anything if we are humble enough to allow God to use them. To walk with God, you must have a teachable spirit. To walk with God, you must have a teachable spirit and be willing to learn from anyone and everyone. The enemy of learning is pride. Sometimes we don't learn the lessons God has for us to learn because we're too busy giving our opinions so we can't hear God tell us what he's trying to tell us. You can learn so much more by asking God questions than you can by giving other people advice. Jesus asked questions. The Canaanites were the enemies. They were always fighting the descendants, and yet he learned the lessons while he was there. In fact, the Bible says in Galatians 6:6, let the one who has taught the word share all good things with the one who teaches. In other words, there is no one who is above learning in life. There is no one, even the way the Bible words phrases this in Galatians, is even the one who's teaching the Bible, even me, right? I can learn from the people who I'm supposed to teach. Now, a lot of times you'll get guys who think they can't, but the truth is God wants us to be humble enough to learn from everyone, even our enemies, even our opponents, even our opposition. Even that one person who, when you see them, you're like, ooh. You ever have that person, you see them on social media, and they post a picture, and you're like, pfft. As soon as they post it, you don't even bother to read the caption, because you're like, yeah, vain. You know, you guys know how it is. Don't judge me. We all know how this is. We can learn from anyone. That couple that posts the pictures, oh yeah, perfect couple, wow, right? We can learn from everyone and anyone. Even people who we don't get along with, we can learn from if we're humble enough. I wonder how often we fight the very lesson that God is trying to teach us because we don't like the person he's using to teach us with. How often we fight who God is trying to use to teach us. See, usually we criticize in others what we don't like about ourselves. Most often, the things we criticize in others is what we don't like about ourselves. We just don't want to admit it. So often, we'll be heavily critical of somebody because we can see their flaw. And the whole time, is God is trying to show us that's our flaw. This is the Christian sin right here. This is why Jesus said to believers, you get so busy trying to remove a speck of dust out of somebody else's eye, you don't even see a telephone pole sticking out of yours. Jesus said this to religious people because this is the flaw of religious people. We so often are so busy pointing out, I don't like this, this, and this, and this, and this about others that we don't see that what we don't like in others is what we actually don't like about ourselves. And that's hard to learn. But we are so busy pointing out what we don't like in others that we don't ever see the lessons God has for us. Maybe we ought to stop spending so much time pointing out the flaws in others and asking God, what are you trying to teach me? But then he ends up in between two places. This is really fascinating to me. He ends up in between, the Bible calls it Hai, nowadays we say Ai, but it means heap of ruins. He's a heap of ruins is on one side and the house of God is on the other, which is ironic because that shows us, right? In life you have choices. You can either make a choice to go towards the presence of God, or you can lead your own life and end up in a heap of ruins. Lot, later on, makes a tragic mistake, and instead of choosing the presence of God, chooses the city because it's well-watered plains, and his life becomes a heap of ruins. Abraham is with his family, and he's in between these two areas. And right now, some of you might feel like areas in your life are in ruins. You might feel like right now, 2020 and COVID and all that's going on has made your marriage into a heap of ruins. You might be looking back and thinking, boy, 2019 was so good with my family, and now we can't even talk to each other. Your family, you ever all got family drama? Man, put 27 of my family in the same house for a while. Let us play one game of aggravations and you'll see family drama. My brother got so mad at my wife for winning the game of Clue. He about threw the board across the room and left. Right? You know, and then he decided he needed to say something, which made my sister then say something to him. And pretty soon, one was talking about women and the other was talking about arrogant men. And they're going back and my mom leaves. Man, it might seem like your family. I'm just going fishing. Like, I don't care if this kid catches anything. I'll paddle him around the rest of the day as long as we don't fight. It might seem like your family is in a heap of ruins. Your relationship status might be, if they still did that on Facebook, I don't know if they do or not, but like single, married, heap of ruins. That ought to be how we determine our relationship status on social media. Maybe your finances are in a heap of ruins right now. Maybe this year has just not been good for you because, let's be honest, it's been tough. Mental health might be in a heap of ruins right now, and you're just struggling, like really struggling, having a hard time. I was talking to someone this week, they said they just kept telling themselves, it would be better if I was dead, because my wife, who doesn't like me anymore, would at least have a bunch of money and thank me for something. And that's how they were approaching this year. And we're on a car ride and I'm trying to explain to this person that's not the answer. But right now that might be where your mental health situation is, where you're looking at it and like, boy, my emotions are a heap of ruins. Right? Like, I don't know how you are, but every time there's a new update, my emotions just go south. Where I'm like, really? Now it's this? Now it's this? Like, we just keep going. You know, pretty soon we'll have giant chickens attacking us or something. I don't feel like that's how 2020 is going to go. Maybe your emotions are in a heap of ruins, or your career is in a heap of ruins, and you're looking at it like, is this really what I want to do with the rest of my life? Maybe that's where you are. When Abraham could see the place of ruins, he built an altar and put up his tent. Think about this for a second. When Abraham had on one side of him a heap of ruins, he built an altar and he put up his tent. What does this tell us? That we need to include our family and God in all of our choices. Right now is not the time to make some solo decision on your own that's going to affect the rest of your life without telling your spouse. Because, well, it's Monday and I'm ticked off. Now's not the time. Are pastors allowed to say ticked off? I feel like that's better than the other words. I hope I can say ticked off. I don't know. This is how things go with us. But now's not the time to make some solo decision that's going to affect your family without at least consulting family and God. He can see the house of God, and he can see the heap of ruins, and he's in the middle. So let's look at Bethel. Bethel can look one way and see the house of God. Abraham can see Bethel, which means the house of God. Nowadays, Bethel has a very powerful meaning to believers. Bethel means the Holy Spirit for us. It's the presence of the Holy Spirit within us. We are Bethel. Our body is the house of God. We don't go to church anymore. We are the church because the Holy Spirit dwells in us. There's this fancy biblical word that sometimes is scary, and Nicolas Cage makes terrible movies about it called Left Behind. And the idea is this rapture or revelation. But really what the rapture is the Spirit of God leaves the earth. The body of God leaves the earth, and His Spirit dwells in us. So He calls His Spirit home, and we as the children of God go with His Spirit. Our bodies are the house of God. But there's also significance in certain places. This is why we go to church still. This is why we have gatherings still. Because Bethel can be a place of remembrance. It can be a place where we gather together and say, yeah, times are hard, but don't you remember what God did back then? Later on, Jacob is going to go to Bethel, and he's going to remember some things in his life, same place. And he's going to have some problems in his life, but he's going to go and he's going to look back when he goes to Bethel at what God brought him and Abraham through. David does this in Psalm chapter, I believe, 46. He says, my life is terrible. My life is awful. He goes through this huge chapter about how hard his life is. And then he says, but I remember how good God has been in my past. Why we gather together is so that we can look at what God has already done and who God is. This is why we have worship. It's why we have singing. It's why we're going to have singing, whether it's legal or not. We're going to sing. Because you can't, we'll just shout then. We'll just breathe loudly. Right? Like we're going to have singing. Because we gather together and we remember who God is and what He has done. This is an essential part of the gathering of Christ. God has brought you through so much already, and it might be time for you to just say, yeah, July 2020 is crazy, but when I look back at what God has done, and I look back at what God has brought me through, I know that God will bring me through this.